morning. Good morning, church, and good morning, Sweeney, Texas.
Yeah.
Good to have you in worship together. My live stream at least brings us a little bit closer together. It's not quite the same as getting out and going to church, but it still is going to church. It still counts. Good to have you with us. We have joys and concerns to be shared. A few of them anyway. We learned recently that Shannon Dodson is back home and feeling better. Good decision, good move, Shannon, and good move to all of you who have been praying for her in the meantime, and praying for all of those who've had some kind of illness or hospitalization. It's just a credit to this church and its faithfulness one to another, and we're thankful for that. The school in West Africa, in Liberia, is going to be opening yet in September. They have made arrangements for social distancing and for masks and for sanitization of hands and so forth. And so school will be opening in the fall, we think. It could be a last-minute decision, but right now keep them in your prayers, especially the students who are so eager to come back and eager to learn. We have received a grant this summer to expand the computer lab. Interesting how the computer is such a teaching instrument, especially for these special needs children. I don't know of any other joys and concerns at this time, so let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Join me in praying the prayer of confession. Let us pray.
most merciful God, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have done those things which we ought not to have done. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare thou those, O God, who confess their faults. Restore thou those who are penitent, according to thy promises declared in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful God, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life,
to the glory of thy holy name. Amen.
Let us continue in a moment of silent and personal meditation. Hear these words of comfort and reassurance. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Will you join now in the affirmation of faith and the Gloria Patri?
I believe in God, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Glory to God the Father, and to
about what the traffic rules are, or if you should be on a bicycle, do you stop at a stop sign or not? You have a friend you could go to and ask? Sure you do. You could ask a police officer, couldn't you? Police officers are here in our communities to help us to know the law, obey the law, and to be safe. Or how about this? You read a Bible verse and it just sounds confusing, and Dad says to you, well, I'm not sure, and Mother says, I don't know, ask your father. Is there somebody else you can go to? Do you know somebody who could help you understand what you're reading in the Bible? I'll give you a hint. Yeah, you can come to me. You can come to your pastor, couldn't you? And we'll talk it out together, as friends would do. Or how about a problem at school, maybe in the classroom, maybe at recess? You have a friend you could talk to about that? Sure you do. You've got friends who are other students, and you've got teachers who are friends. So, maybe a parent, member of the family, a police officer, a pastor, a teacher. You've got friends all around you, and you have God, who surrounds you with his love. Let's share a prayer together. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for our families.
Thank you for our families.
Thank you for our friends.
Thank you for our friends.
And thank you that you love us so.
And thank you for loving us so.
Amen.
Amen.
See you next week. Will you join me in prayer? Gracious Lord Jesus, today we lift up those in need of your presence. And there are so many, and we pray for peace for those who are passing through waters that would seem to overcome them. We pray prayers of strength for those who are passing through rivers, beset by the raging currents of life. We pray prayers of protection for those who are passing through fires of tribulation, that they will not be burned. We pray prayers of faith for one who is venturing into uncharted water. We pray prayers of wisdom for the one who is making some major decision. We pray prayers of love for the one who is feeling rejected and unloved. We pray prayers of comfort for the one who is grieving. And we pray prayers of contentment for the one who wants to let go of material things and walk with you. Bless these prayers, we pray, O Lord, and may we all find all we need as we seek to do your will in every situation. You are the image of the invisible God at the head of all creation. In you all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through you and for you. You are before all things and in all things you hold together. You are the head of the body, the church. Nothing is impossible with you. Therefore, we come to you and we pray in your name, even as our Lord taught us to pray, saying,
suggest you come a little forward. You seem a little far away from us here. Maybe bring your stand up.
Our reading in the Old Testament is from the 37th chapter of Psalms. These verses.
Okay, that's good.
Trust in the Lord and do good. So you will dwell in the land and enjoy security. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your ways to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will act. You will bring forth your vindication as the light, and your right shall be as the noonday. And then turning to the letter to the Hebrews in the 13th chapter, these verses. Hence we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can anyone do to me? Remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God. Consider the outcome of their life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not be led away by diverse and strange teachings, for it is well that the heart be strengthened by grace, not by fools or foods, which have not benefited their adherents. We have an altar from which those who serve the tent have no right to eat, for the bodies of the animals whose blood is brought into the sanctuary belongs to the high priest as a sacrifice for sin and are burned outside the camp. And so Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Here ends the reading of God's word to us. May it be a blessing for our daily living. While we don't know exactly who the author was of the letter to the Hebrews, we do know that it was a letter written by Jewish Christians living either in Palestine or perhaps even in Rome. They were being persecuted for their new faith, for their belief in the resurrected Jesus Christ, and the temptation for them, certainly the easy way out, was for them to return to Judaism. The author here was writing to encourage them to stay the course and grow in their newly found Christian faith. Clearly, these are very uncertain times in which we live. We've said it before, but perhaps it never really had the impact it does for us today. The author of Hebrews was being practical in reminding them that uncertain times are a fact of life. There will always be change and uncertainty. I remember talking with a retired firefighter in our community back in Iowa. We talked about the change occurring on even church-related campuses. And at the end of the conversation, he said, "Well, Doc, don't get me wrong, I don't mind change, but it's..."
No, I don't mind progress. I don't mind progress.
I don't mind progress.
It's change.
It's change I can't stand.
Yeah.
And then as a word of encouragement, the writer to Hebrews writes, their port in the storm, the part of their lives that never has changed and never will change. And that was their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He said to them, remember the leaders who taught you and led you to Christ. Sure. They were not perfect, and certainly they made mistakes, but remember all the good things about them and try to imitate them and what they taught. And then most importantly, remember this. The resurrected Christ is perfect in every way. He does not make mistakes. He does not waffle back and forth. The author concluded this thought with these words that we remember so well. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. In a word, constant change, even uncertainty. Jesus Christ and his promises to his people have always and will always remain the same. For us, this is a very special and important time in the life and for the future of our country. Not the first time we've been confronted with a challenge of such enormous change. Such times began in our country when the pilgrims left their homeland in search of religious freedom, and they set sail, surrounded by uncertainty. Just imagine the massive uncertainty. uncertainty when a small group of colonists got together and decided to sever ties with Mother England and become a nation in our own right. My grandfather McLaughlin was like that back in his day. He had a small hardware store in that town of 750, Langford, South Dakota. And he had two younger brothers. Vern was the plumber and Ernest was the electrician. Well, my grandfather at one point added another section to his hardware store, an L on the back of the store, and he put new furniture in it. After all, people from Marshall County would come into the hardware store and buy the lumber and the hinges and whatever they needed to build the coffin for the deceased. And it wasn't long until the town fathers came to my grandfather and asked, you know, we don't have a funeral home in Langford. Could we use that furniture part of your store as a place to gather? Sure, that was a great idea. But what came next wasn't expected. Some weeks later, the same group of town fathers were talking to my grandfather in the store and said, you know, Artie, we don't have a mortician in all of Marshall County. And so my grandfather got on the train and went to Minneapolis. And after 2 weeks of training, he came back to Langford as a certified mortician.
2 weeks.
The year was 1918. It was the start of the Spanish flu epidemic, pandemic, as our soldiers came back from World War I. Even my grandfather's brother, Ernest, returned from the war. But neither Ernest, nor Vern, nor my grandfather caught the flu. My grandfather had a stock tank out in his garage. It was filled with formaldehyde. And after tending a body and preparing it for burial and embalming the body, he would remove his coveralls and douse them in the tank to sanitize the coveralls. But my grandmother always had a brand new bar of lava soap on the side of the tank. And Grandpa was to be sure he scrubbed in his hands and his arms and get that smell of formaldehyde off of him so that when he came in the house for dinner that night, they could enjoy a home-cooked meal. But as my mother told the story, it wasn't long after they sat down for dinner in the dining room that Grandma began to smile, and then she began to chuckle, and all were chuckling together because you don't get rid of that smell of formaldehyde, not even with lava soap. But Grandma did organize the ladies of the four churches in Langford, the Methodist, Presbyterian, the Catholic, and the Lutherans. And the ladies of those churches prepared three meals a day for each of those fellow citizens who are in quarantine in a two-story de facto hospital, usually schoolhouse. But even with that exposure, none of the family came down with the flu. So the experience is not new, although the experience today is much like what they must have been going through in 1918. What do you do in your own defense? Just imagine the massive uncertainty when a small group went off to World War I for the first time to defend this country overseas. The Great Depression in 1929, the start of World War II and our entrance in 1944, the Korean conflict, and then Vietnam and more recently Kuwait, Iraq, and Afghanistan. The purpose of my message this morning is to encourage us to look out and see the big picture out of a picture window that shows the horizon and the landscape of all that is around us and take in as much of that landscape as our eyes will allow. If you have ever been on a ship, you know what it's like to look out the round portal in your stateroom, but you also know what it's like to stand on the deck and take in the view of 360 degrees around you. This morning I'm urging us to stand together on that deck and to look in the same direction, to look ahead where this ship of state is going. Recently my brother received an email from a friend of his, a golfing friend, whose son was a Methodist pastor in western Nebraska. The pastor had composed a top 10 list. Now, we've all seen the top 10 lists, and we read them for no other reason, out of curiosity. But this one in particular has a message. Let me share it with you. Here we go. Top 10 list for surviving the pandemic. Number one, God will still be on his throne. Number two, Jesus will still be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Number three, the Bible will still have all the answers to problems we raise. Number four, the tomb will still be empty. Number five, Jesus will still be the only way to heaven. Number six, prayer will still work, it will still make a difference, and God will still answer our prayers. Number seven, the cross will be our salvation. Number eight, there will still be room at the cross. Number nine, Jesus will still save anyone who places his or her faith and trust in him. And number 10, God will still be with us always. He will never leave us or forsake us. That's the big picture you see when you stand down on the bow of a ship. That's the big picture that shows us all that surrounds us, the landscape of life that we take in, and we look out into the future. This top 10 list verifies what the author of Hebrews was saying when he wrote, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, and today, and forever. To live life faithfully in the face of uncertainty today, tomorrow, and the day after that, we must remember the changeless truths that God revealed to the world, to our world. In the 37th Psalm, David takes us even further down the road of living by faith, not by sight. David gives some very specific steps for us to take in times of uncertainty. He began by saying in that psalm, trust in the Lord and do good. David knew that a fearful heart or a heart filled with uncertainty is not a trusting heart. To live in fear and doubt takes its toll on anyone, physically, emotionally, spiritually. To trust in the Lord who, unlike the world, never changes, is comforting, reassuring, strengthening. David was also aware that the faith and good works that go hand in hand. As we trust in the Lord, we will be led to doing the good works he had designed for us to do. In 1918, that's how Artie McLaughlin and fellow citizens of Langford made it through their troubled time with the pandemic of Spanish flu. And then David went on to say, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. To delight ourselves in the Lord is to dwell in his presence and to experience his abundant blessings. When David said that God will give you the desires of your heart, he's not thinking about the long-awaited Maserati. It's something else that you desire as a great earthly reward for all the goodness of life. Instead, David knew that when we live in the presence of God, our deepest wishes are there for that which pleases the Lord. It is when our wishes are in harmony with God's wishes that God will give you the desires of your heart. And then David switched gears a bit and urged his people to be still before the Lord and to wait patiently for him. Most of us aren't really that good about waiting patiently, especially in silence for him. Most of us are glad there are such things as remote controls. So that when the television goes blank and silent, we can hurry up and change the channel. And silent will begin to hurry up and be no more. To be still before the Lord and to wait patiently for him means we surrender our will to his will. It means in our partnership with him, he is the guide, and we are the ones who will follow. So today we have a choice to make. We can either stew in the uncertainty and threats in our lives, or we can delight ourselves in the Lord who frees us up and makes it all possible to be still before Him and wait patiently for Him. And finally, in that 37th Psalm, David warns us not to envy or get angry over the temporary successes of evil of other people in the world, because their luxury will be short-lived. David instructed us to remember instead that those who hope in the Lord will inherit the road. In closing, let me say this. The world in which we live is filled with uncertainty, and uncertainty is no stranger to these United States. The answer to our uncertainties lies with Him who created the universe and who dwelt among our forefathers and mothers, who founded this great nation as one nation under God. So let us live through the uncertainty of remembering the promise of God given to King Solomon one night after the temple in Jerusalem had been constructed. That night God said to Solomon, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear them from heaven and will forgive them their sin and will heal their land." So let us go forth from this time of worship this morning and be leaders in an uncertain world, showing others how to trust in the Lord and do good, showing them how to delight ourselves in the Lord and become the receptacle of His abundant blessings. Let us show them how to commit our ways to the Lord and how to be silent before the Lord and wait patiently for Him. And let us show others how to refrain from being envious and angry over the gains made by the wicked and choose instead to be a people who hope in the Lord and one day will indeed inherit the land. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. During this moment of offertory, we think of the gifts that we bring to the church, and you may continue to do so. The office is open Monday through Thursday, or send them through the mail. We think, too, of giving not only of our tithes and offerings, but ourselves, our time, our service. And while we meditate on that, we listen thankfully to special music by Greg Wiggers.
Thank you.
closing hymn this morning is Standing on the Promises. And you can stand on the promises while you're sitting on the premises. So if you're at home or wherever, you might
want us to sit.
Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages, let His grace us bring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and say, standing on the promises of God.
Today? Ooh, today is Margie. Margie.
16th. Today is the 16th, and Margie Woodworth is celebrating her birthday.
Yeah.
Margie is now in
Lufkin.
Mm-hmm. And we hope that they are still doing well and listening and sharing. Mm-hmm. And we share that joy with your birthday as we think all those good memories we had together here in Sweeney with you, Margie. Coming up this week on the 18th, can you guess? Cindy Scarborough.
Oh.
Our main engineer of live streaming, engineer and consultant. Happy birthday, Cindy.
Thank you.
Senator Glick on the 20th, Sue Walker on the 21st, Peggy Ellis and Wade Nairn on the 22nd, Marvin Brown on the 23rd. Lots of birthdays that are coming up this week. Announcements, not many. We don't have a lot of activities at the church until further notice. But there will be at least one person in the office each day, Monday through Thursday. Monday, Casey Womack will be in the office. Tuesday and Thursday, Marty Lavender will be there from 8 to 12:30, her usual hours. And then most of Wednesday, I'll be there doing the work of the church in the morning, and then in either late morning or early afternoon, we'll be begin live streaming the broadcast for a playback on Sunday, we think. One way or the other, next Sunday, there will be a live stream.
Yeah.
Remember, too, that even though we're not physically there on a Friday or in the afternoons, we can still be contacted by cell phone. I still travel and I make hospital calls I'm not always able to go into the room of the person who is ill, but if the family is visiting, then I have a chance to be with the family. So don't hesitate to call them and let us know. At the very least, we can activate the prayer chain. Mm-hmm.
And with that, Dan Ellis, is it Dan?
Dan Ellis.
Mm-hmm. Would like our prayers.
He's still okay. He's still recovering from that fall. And
yeah, I think he went in for a steroid shot or something like that. Mm-hmm. I got a message, but I didn't get to read it all. But let's pray for Dan and Peggy.
Let's keep Dan Ellis in our prayers. Yeah. Thank you. We are still collecting items for the garage sale, and there will be a garage sale sooner or later.
Sometime.
So keep those items coming. If it's a large item, give us a little heads up. We can have somebody there to meet you and to help you unload it. We don't know how long you're
Waiting for prayers for me, because I come through that every day.
Oh, that's right. That's answered prayer.
Yeah.
Mike Corn came through his cataract surgery on Thursday, right?
Right.
And now he sees bright on the one side, and the other side is ready. When do you go in for the other cataract surgery?
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Oh, boy.
So in the meantime, he is seeing multicolor vision.
Yeah.
But we want to keep Mike in our prayer, too, and his wife, Gail. Mm-hmm. Same time. Mike is another one of those veterans who, not only served in the military, but has served for some time up in the balcony behind the soundboard. Keeps things going and lively. We don't know how long this is going to be the way that we meet with each other, but our main concern here at the church is the safety and the health of all of our friends and members. We thank you for your understanding. And with that, let's conclude with our benediction. I can do all things.
I can do all things.
Through Christ.
Through Christ.
Who strengthens me.
Who strengthens me.
Bless me, the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love.
Blessed. Be safe.